Bonsoir.
Good evening. Welcome to the auditorium. We know why so many of you have come this evening. We're very fortunate to be welcoming Patti Smith. Jérôme Neutre, the curator of the Mapplethorpe exhibition, is going to be having a discussion with her. This is a special evening. Thank you very much for being here.
Jesus died for somebody's sins, but not mine. Milton, pot of thieves, wild cord on my sleeve. Thick, heart of stone, my sins my own, they belong to me, me.
Bonsoir.
Good evening. Good evening. Thank you for coming in such great number to welcome Patti Smith. She's honoring us and being friendly enough to come support this project of a retrospective of Robert Mapplethorpe at the Grand Palais. She took part in this and, among other things, wrote an unpublished work that you'll find in the exhibition catalog. After having written a surprising story called Just Kids, a book which has now been translated into 44 different languages, it's amazing. On 18 June, we'll also be meeting with someone else from Robert Mapplethorpe catalog, Edmund White, novelist who also knew Robert very well. Also, this evening in attendance, we have the Robert Mapplethorpe Foundation. They're, of course, the special partner, an essential partner. They've been giving great support to us in organizing the exhibition. Michael Stott, their president, is here. Eric Johnson, Jerry Edelman, and Dimitri Levis, who worked a very long time with Robert Mapplethorpe. Patti, you told me you wanted to begin this session, this meeting, by saying a few words about the exhibition.
Hello, everybody. This afternoon, I was driving around the city with my friend Tomas,
and
we passed the Grand Palais, and this little song came in my head, and so I thought I would present this little song, a petite chanson, instead of words. It was raining in Paris right from the start. Rain streaking my face like tears in the heart. I rode through the city, and what did I see? Your face on a banner looking at me. The dreams of a girl have no fear. The banner at the palace whispered, I'm here. It was raining in Paris, yet I felt a joy. The dreams were fulfilled of a girl and a boy.
Merci, merci, Patti.
Thank you, Patti. Thank you.
You were at that time together reading quite a lot of French literature. For you, in fact, you were reading to Robert some French literature.
Well, Robert and I shared the things that that were important to us. Robert shared with me tantric art and surrealism and erotic art and the things and many technical skills. He taught me many things in terms of executing drawings. And I shared with him my love of French literature and read. Robert wasn't a big reader, so at night, like fairy tales, I would read him Genet or poems of Rimbaud, and he was a good listener, And he loved them all. He would ask me for, read me the one part in Miracle of the Rose where you know, his heart transforms into a rose, or read me the Drunken Boat. And so we shared the things that were important to each of us.
And Querelle de Brest also, you told me.
Yes, yes. And there was a Robert. Of course, one of the twins was named Robert. Yes.
And I think you can see, one can see in the, and through the exhibition in the Grand Palais, the correspondences with those thematics with Genet. But at that time, you were living in New York together, and New York was a different New York than today. It's a surge of energy, tremendous, explosion, you used to say.
We were really lucky because in 1967, we lived in Brooklyn, very isolated. We were quite young, we were 20. We had no money, and we spent all of our time either trying to make a living, I worked in a bookstore, or working on drawings and some of the collages or early pieces that you see in the exhibit. But in 1969, we went to the Chelsea Hotel, and it was an amazing time. We went there innocently. We had nowhere else to go. We just thought, we'll try that place. And it was the absolute perfect place for us to be because everyone passed through the lobby of the Chelsea Hotel. Everyone stayed there. I mean, we've met rock stars and Tennessee Williams, and one day it might be Godard came in, and Muhammad Ali, and Jimi Hendrix, and William Burroughs, and Salvador Dali, Janis Joplin. All of these people stayed or visited the Chelsea Hotel, and our cultural voice was a very exploding, burgeoning reality. You know, it was the sexual revolution, the war, the protest against Vietnam, musical revolution, political revolution. It was just the perfect place to be for two young people who were, you know, ready for anything.
And it was a very cheap city at that time. One cannot imagine now that New York is so expensive. It's why there was so many artists.
Yes, I mean, that was the beauty of New York. New York was failing. It was economically bankrupt, not as bad as a city like Detroit, but it was in great trouble. And you could get a very cheap apartment. Maybe it had rats, maybe it had cockroaches, but you could get it. And there were just hundreds, or not thousands, of people of like mind in the theater, in poets and musicians and painters, and people at that time, because the celebrity of the culture of celebrity was not so important, it was not so big. We all interacted, and so we weren't separated from the generation before us. It was very easy to talk to artists who were, who were our mentors or could be our teachers. We all sort of integrated at parties or at the hotel.
And also with intellectuals, writers, philosophers, no? There was this interaction that Swain Moon White described in his text, Susan Sontag. You were close also to Burroughs, Ginsberg.
Yes, but I mean, the thing is, we all danced together. You know, we'd be at Max's Kansas City. All of these people, such intelligent, interesting, creative people, and we were dancing together, trying to scrape up money together. It was quite an electric world, it was.
An electric world. When we visited the show at the Grand Palais, you said that it was fascinating to see when I told you that how much you look like Robert in those portraits. And you told me that you can see both of you in those photos.
Well, I probably see different things than people. I can look at every single picture and remember what was happening in when we were taking that picture. I mean, I don't even remember whole photo shoots with other people. They just pass by. But with Robert, I can look at the picture and think, oh, we were fighting, you know, or I was really annoyed, or he was teasing me, or I was afraid, or there's, you know, I know for this pic, oh, the wrong, well, that picture, for instance, I had an accident and I had a neck brace and I had to have it on for 4 months. And I was afraid to, I couldn't take it off. And Robert came with his camera and said, take off the neck brace, take off. And I'm like, no, no, I can't, my head will fall off. I was so afraid. And he looked at me and said, nothing will happen to you. I'll be right here. And he just, and I believed him. He always protected me. And so I took it off and I can see my eyes, I'm looking right in his eyes with just a little fear, like a deer, you know, but I was looking right in his eyes. Where another picture, when I was cutting my hair, I was looking at his eyes, but I was really pissed off. So it's when I see these pictures, I see us.
Et c'est vrai qu'il y a une ressemblance, une sorte de gémellité qu'on voit entre vous deux. D'ailleurs,
we can see a similarity between the two of you. You were sort of like the brother and sister of in Cocteau.
You're asking me.
You were like the brother and sister, yes, playing together.
Well, Robert, both Robert and I liked Jean Cocteau very much. Robert loved the fact that artists such as Andy Warhol and Cocteau, Marcel Duchamp, created a world around them. They didn't, they weren't just creating art, but a whole world, which included collaborators and different genres, film and design and poetry. And I think more and more, if Robert would have lived, he would have worked more to cultivate such a world, because he was interested and also completely equipped and skilled in so many different genres. He could design furniture, jewelry, sculpture, and take photographs, do elegant, beautiful drawings. He was a fine draftsman. And so he liked this multiple world. But we also liked, when we were young, Enfant Terrible, because the sister and brother, Elizabeth and Paul, they loved and fought all the time, which Robert and I did. We bickered and loved, and we also loved to find treasure. Paul and Elizabeth in Enfant Terrible would find some plaster cast of a head or some mitten of a poet and declare it treasure, excuse me, and put the treasure in their room. And Robert and I would do the same thing. One night, we were walking to Max's Kansas City from the Chelsea Hotel, and right on the street were a pair of beautiful shoes, like Berluti shoes. Beautiful, I don't know why they were there. It was like, they were like a miracle, just the glowing shoes. And we looked at them, and they were too big for Robert. And we looked at each other, and we were saying, art? Art, treasure, you know, practical item. And we declared that they should be all three. And Robert used them in an installation. He wore them with lots of toilet paper, like he stuffed the toes. And I believe he photographed them. And they were also adored. So that's the kind of things that we would do that remind me of Enfant Terrible.
One thing I think the visitors will discover visiting the show at the Grand Palais is that before to be a photographer, Robert Mapplethorpe was really an artist, a visual artist. And one can see in the show that he started by making some real sculptures. And like this lamb box, you can say, but speak this
well,
December.
The lamb box is a really lovely little piece. But Robert, it just shows how beautiful everything he did was. It wasn't done as art. It was really, we made it together to give this little orphaned lamb that we found a home. But I think as much as that, when you look at Robert's early pieces, you can see that he was adept in putting together all kinds of the relationship. I'm sorry, I just got confused.
In the collage also.
No, yes. What I really want to say is, the heck with all that. What I really want to say is Robert came out of the womb an artist. People can't decide they're going to be artists. I believe that real artists are either blessed or cursed by God, and they come to the world as an artist, and they find through various trials and suffering the fact that they are an artist. And that, to me, is the most important thing one can see in seeing Robert's early work. He was always an artist. He struggled with sculpture or with certain ideas. He conquered all of his struggles. And even as a photographer, I can't ever think of Robert as a photographer. He's an artist. His photographs, anyone can take pictures. There's many photographers. Being a photographer doesn't make you an artist. He was an artist who took photographs. And so that is why when you look at his photographs, they're elevated. And when you look at Robert's photographs of such a thing as, his S&M pictures or a finger inserting itself, a man inserting his finger in the slit of a cock, what you see is something elevated as art. Robert wasn't interested in just, being controversial or provocative. He wanted to do something no one else had done, and that is lift certain subject matter into the realm of art, like Genet.
Exactly.
But I went off my course. I'm sorry.
No. This is great.
Sorry.
No, this is great.
Anyway.
Right, go on. With
no, you talk.
No, it's exactly that. He used to say in many interviews, I want people to see my images first as art, second as photography. I think exactly what you said. You wanted to read an excerpt of Just Kids, you told me.
Okay. Hi.
Yes.
I'm going to go. Yeah. I don't like the post.
Sorry that I got sidetracked or nervous, but truthfully, I would so much rather hear Robert talk than me telling stories about Robert. And sometimes when I'm talking about Robert, I just wish I could just hear his voice instead of mine. But I'm going to read just a little thing since we were talking about when we were young near the Chelsea Hotel. This is the end of the 60s, and it was around, it was Christmas time, 1969. It snowed on Christmas night. Robert and I walked to Times Square to see the white billboard proclaiming, "War is over. If you want it, Happy Christmas from John and Yoko." It hung above the bookstall where Robert bought most of his men's magazines between Child's and Benedict's, to all-night diners. Looking up, we were struck by the ingenuous humanity of this New York City tableau. Robert took my hand, and as the snow swirled around, I glanced at his face. He narrowed his eyes and nodded in affirmation, impressed to see artists taking on 42nd Street. For me, it was the message. For Robert, the medium. Newly inspired, we walked back to 23rd Street to look at our new space. The necklaces we had made hung on hooks, and he had tacked up some of our drawings. We stood at the window and looked out at the snow falling beyond the fluorescent oasis sign with its squiggly palm tree. "Look," he said, "it's snowing in the desert." I thought about a scene in Howard Hawks' movie Scarface where Paul Muni and his girl were looking out the window at a neon sign that said, "The world is yours." Robert squeezed my hand. The 60s were coming to an end. Robert and I celebrated our birthdays. Robert turned 23. Then I turned 23, the perfect prime number. Robert made me a tie rack with the image of the Virgin Mary. I gave him 7 silver skulls on a length of leather. He wore the skulls. I wore a tie. We felt ready for the 70s. "It's our decade," he said.
In the exhibition, one can see also a film you made with Robert, Still Moving. Can you talk about the conditions? Because a lot of people are very surprised to see a film.
I think the film is really one of my favorite collaborations that we did, because many things were encompassed within it. Robert's photographic eye, he took stills as we were filming it. His editing sense, he edited it, he put it together. He set up the backdrops, and it also contains music, poetry, and it's entirely improvised. It's the way Robert and I worked. He just called me one day and he said, we had pulled some money together, and he said, "Want to do a film later today?" And I said, "Okay." And he said, "Well, come over around 4. And I said, "Okay." So I gathered some stuff up in a bag and went over to his loft. And he had set up white net, this beautiful white net. He had made, like, I had never seen him do such a thing. It was really like a little theater of white net. And it was a little theater for me. I just stepped into it, and we began the film. We didn't speak about it. We didn't say what we were going to do. Robert got his camera. And this film exhibits really the best of what we did together, really based on trust, alchemy, and a combined intelligence. And I mean, that's all I can really say. Oh, there is one other thing, is I didn't take very many drugs in the 70s, but Robert wanted me to take something called MDA. And I was a little afraid. I said, "Is it weird?" And he goes, "It'll be fine, and I'm here." And really, any time that Robert, you know, asked me to go a little further than normal, he always reassured me that he would be there. And believe me, he was. He was, you know, as a friend, he was always there. If you fell, he would catch you. And so I took it. So there is a little, I don't know what the MDA did, but it has magnified the film or slanted it in a very interesting way. And even without it, I know that it would have also have been interesting. But it points to why my eyes, which is a still, this is a still from the film. I have a lazy eye, which I try to I try to keep my eyes focused, but it was really difficult to keep my eyes focused. And Robert caught it in a photograph. He was very proud of that because he was always trying to get me to, he wanted to get a shot of me with my eyes moving, and he got it. Maybe that's why he gave me the MDA, just for that shot, you know. But I'm very proud of the film. And the stills he took were beautiful. My favorite part of the film is you can watch Robert loading the camera. It's just the close-up of his hands with his beautiful veined hands, and he's loading the camera. But then I suppose I got into a strange emotional frame of mind, and I could not move my hand. It was probably drug-related, but you can see, Robert could see I was in a little bit of trouble, and he walks into the frame and presses his hand against mine to steady me. And that is the most, you know, the most beautiful illustration, I think, of our friendship, and my favorite part of the film.
Thank you for this making of secret. The text of Still Moving is your text, the text you are saying.
Yes,
it's the text you wrote before. It's
no,
improvisation.
No, it's all improvised. I improvised quite a lot, and especially in that time period, I improvised a lot on stage, and it's what I preferred. I don't like, even now, I don't like working from a script. So it's how we shot the cover of Horses too. Robert and I didn't plan anything. We just said, we planned what time we were gonna meet. The only thing Robert ever told me is if it was an important picture like Horses, an album cover, was not to wear a shirt that had like olive oil or spaghetti stains on it, because I'm really messy. And he was like, that's the only thing he asked. Nothing else. He didn't ask anything specific, just wear a clean shirt.
He liked, you said many times that he liked to put everything in order in a way. And it was maybe due to, it's also Catholic culture.
Yes, well, Robert has beautiful, there's a few beautiful quotes of Robert's about that. We used to talk about what our upbringing. I had a very intense biblical education. I was a Jehovah's Witness, and Robert was a Catholic. In Jehovah's Witness churches or halls, there are no artifacts. There's no imagery. There's no crosses, no statues, nothing, just an empty room, and it's all word-based, all scripture-based. And of course, Catholicism, you know, is, you know, a world of art. So, and arrangement and altars. And so it seemed like I was always trying to make everything messy and take the emptiness out of my life and fill it up with things. And Robert was always placing things in order. He was always, whether it was our mantelpiece or, you know, everything looked like a very warm art installation with Robert. And he used to always say that that was what he got out of Catholicism, was the arrangement of space, the arrangement of objects or of objects in space. From tantric art, he really got a lot of his geometric use of geometry and the game board type of things he did in collages, or the when you see the, for instance, there's a beautiful triangle with three colors. It really resonates his love of tantric art.
With the Mapplethorpe name.
What?
Yes, with the Mapplethorpe name on it, the triangle. It's why he made a book entitled Altars. He was speaking a lot about altars, the concept of altars.
Well, I really loved the fact that what Robert called an altar didn't have to have anything to do with religious imagery or religion. He might do an altar that had all male imagery, or it could have a knife and a whip or whatever. You know, it was more about an altar. Was more about the it was about the arrangement, and a spiritual arrangement, having nothing to do with religion, though.
In its contents, in its form,
yes.
It was in its shape. It's very interesting. And among those arrangements are, and when we can see in the exhibition at the Grand Palais, some unique pieces made with canvas, silk. And you told me that you have seen with him in 1986, I think, for example, Thomas and Davana and some things. And he was quite proud. It was like an achievement for him.
Well, I mean, he's speaking of the fact that I think it was in 86, one of Robert's works arrived at his loft, and it was Thomas and Davana, is that her? Sorry. Yes. And it's so beautiful, this beautiful black man who is nude, dancing with a girl in a white satin dress with moiré satin panels. And it was in brown paper, and took it out of the brown paper and set it up, and we stood there. And he stood there, and then he said, "It's genius, isn't it?" And but what was wonderful is Robert was always like that. It wasn't that he thought he had done something just very special with this. He loved his work. His work were his children. He loved his work. You know, sometimes he got bored or he might abandon certain things. But when something 100% realized his creative impulse, he loved it. And so he should. His love of his work resonated. His confidence resonated. His confidence that he was an artist. He wasn't a doubting person. You know, I was like the dramatic, oh, am I really a poet? Oh, my poetry sucks. Oh, I hate myself, you know. And he had no time for that. You know, he's like, you know, cut the crap and do your work. You know, he didn't doubt his abilities. He doubted that sometimes in people recognizing his abilities, but he didn't doubt them himself, which was one of his beauties. And certainly he helped to instill confidence in me. It was one of his great gifts to me, was to help me develop confidence in myself as a worker or as an artist, and without doubt. And even today, when I feel myself faltering, I go all the way back to 1967, when he was helping me to build my strength, and then I feel, you know, ready for the world again.
Thank you. Robert Mapplethorpe was not listening so much music, you told me, but he had some songs he liked. You were listening music.
No. He wasn't a reader. Yeah. He wasn't a big reader, but he did like music. I mean, he liked specific music. And, but he was patient. Like, I love listening to opera. He wouldn't listen to the whole opera, but he would listen to the hit, you know, like he would listen to Belle D or, you know, the beautiful aria. But he really loved Motown. He loved music he could dance to. He liked psychedelic music. You know, he liked to have a good time. I mean, Robert was a serious artist, but he also loved to laugh. He loved to dance, and we had this one thing when we were young. Robert would sometimes, not often, because we didn't have any money, but every once in a while a friend would give him like a tab of acid and he'd take LSD. I didn't take it, and I wouldn't know that he had taken it, except after a while we'd be sitting there and he'd put on this Vanilla Fudge album. And I hated this album. But when I saw he was putting on Vanilla Fudge, I thought, uh-oh, he's tripping. Because all night long, he would listen to the same album over and over. And it was it was like a 14-minute version of one song in slow motion, like, set me free, why don't you, babe? And I'd be, oh no, we're gonna listen to this all night long. But he was always, you know, we would just talk and listen to Vanilla Fudge for 12 hours. But most of the time, Robert would be working. He had a very strong work ethic. Especially, you know, as a young man, before he was working with the immediacy of the Polaroid or photographs, where he could do his work in a shorter period of time. When he was working on his drawings or collages or installations, he would work 10, 12 hours straight. He was a hard worker.
Yes, and he completed a huge body of work in 20 years.
Would you like a little song?
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
I thought, you know, that I would sing a little song.
Yes. I think people will be very happy here, if you don't mind.
I'm a really bad guitar player, so I wouldn't clap too quick. But I can play enough to. To sing a song. This little song is called "Grateful," and you know, it's. I just want to dedicate this song to all those who have made this exhibition possible, and to Michael Stout and his team. The Robert Mapplethorpe Foundation has really, I mean, Robert did his work and he was a great artist, but when a great artist passes, what happens to his legacy? If it falls in the wrong hands, he can be all but forgotten. And because the Mapplethorpe Foundation has shepherded his work, he is now everywhere in the world and he's here tonight in Paris. So I'm very grateful, and this is for you. Is that on? Oops, is that on? Sorry. Okay.
Is just another skin, simply slips away. You can rise above it. It was shed easily. It all will come out fine. I've learned it line by line. One coming wire, one silver thread, all that you desire rolls on ahead. Like a ship in a bottle, held up to the sun, sails ain't going nowhere. You can count everyone until it crashes into the earth, simply slips away. You can hide in the open or just disappear. It all will come out fine. I've learned it line by line. One coming wire, one silver thread, all that you desire rolls on ahead. Ours is just a craving and a twist of the wrist. We'll undo the stopper with abrupt tenderness. Die, little sparrow, and awake, singing. It all will come out fine. I've learned it line by line. One coming wire, one silver thread, all that you desire rolls on ahead. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Grateful.
Thank you, Patti, and thank you on behalf of the Réunion des Musées Nationaux Grand Palais and our president Jean-Paul Cluzel also for your support in this exhibition and for your support in the time of the opening of the exhibition. You have you went to talk to a lot of press and to us, and it's very moving to have you with us for this great event. So thank you very much. Just after this encounter, I know that you agreed to sign some books. Yes. In the bookshop of the Galerie Nationale du Grand Palais, just downstairs, où donc on vous donne rendez-vous.
So we'll be meeting in a few minutes' time for the book signing.
Well, I'll sing one more song, but I sang this song the other thing. It's okay.
Conclure en chanson.
I can only play a few chords, so I can't really play all of my songs. But I'll sing one. But I wanted to say that in terms of my singing, I never wanted to be a singer. I never had any designs to be a singer, but I used to sing little songs to Robert. My mother was a singer. We sang songs at the house. I used to sing little songs to Robert, little songs also to help him go to sleep, or just because he liked it. And Robert used to always tell me, "You should sing, you should sing." And I'd say, "No, no, no." And then I was writing poetry, and he would say, "You should read your poetry, you should perform." I don't want to do that. And but he pressed me to do so. And so I had a whole life singing and saw the world. But the day before Robert died, he asked me to write our story. And I promised him I would do it. And it took me a long time. But I did it, and again, Robert led me to do something that I hadn't intended to do, which gave me access to the world and to so many people. So I'm grateful for everything that Robert has done for me, not only in our long friendship and our young life, but still as I walk through life, you know, with him somewhere. So I hope you enjoy the exhibit. It's one to return to and think about and see from different angles. And thank you for coming.
Thank you.
I sang this last night, so I'm sorry to be redundant, but this song is really, Robert and I both loved William Blake, and we studied his work and looked at his drawings and read his poems many, many hours when we were younger. William Blake was an inspiration, especially to us when we were young, because we did struggle quite a bit. We had no money, sometimes had no money to eat. But William Blake went through his whole life, a master printer, a beautiful draftsman, a great philosopher, an activist. He wrote songs and poems. He gave us so much. But in his lifetime, he never had any success, no success. He was a true victim of the Industrial Revolution. People were not interested anymore in his hands-on approach to art. They wanted things run off of the great presses and the mills. And he was nearly forgotten in his time. There was no one, there was no William Blake Foundation to shepherd his work. And it was nearly forgotten, except for the poet W.B. Yeats helped to revive him in 1927. But William Blake, in his lifetime, did his work. I watched Robert, having not eaten for almost 24 hours, continue to work on a collage or a drawing or a piece of work with his hands shaking. And he did his work, and that's the most important thing. You know, all of the things that excite us or interest us, lifestyle or, you know, what people are thinking or what they did or what they were wearing or all of these things are exciting, but in the end, it's the work that endures. So this little salute to William Blake is also a salute to the struggle of the artist.
In my Blakean year, I was so disposed toward a mission yet unclear, advancing pole by pole. My chin breathed into my ear, obey the simple code. When road was paved in gold, when road was just a road. Am I Blakean year? Such a woeful schism, the pain in our existence was not as I envisioned. I tramp from track to track, worn down to the soul. When road was paved in gold, when road was just a road. Am I Blakean? Yeah. Temptation yet a hiss, just a shallow spear, robed in cowardice. Brace yourself for bitter flack, for a life divine. A labyrinth of riches never shall unwind. The tears that bind the pilgrim sack are stitched into the Blakeyan back. So throw off your stupid cloak, embrace all that you fear, 'cause joy will conquer all despair in my Blakeyan year. So throw off your stupid cloak, embrace all that you fear, joy will conquer all despair in my Blakeyan year, in my Blakeyan year, in my Blakeyan year.
Thank you.